So watercolor is water and color. Just like when you're showering, you wash and you have the towel dry.
Hardest part about painting is procuring the paint.
Hello, my name is Mengju. I'm an artist. Today, I'll be reviewing some of the watercolors that you might come across. So the first one, the Sakura Matte Watercolors. So this one is from Popular for $12.60, and you got a whole bunch of colors. Quite worth it because you don't need a lot of watercolor to make a little painting. And my favorite thing about this is it's like a childhood thing. They have this thing where you can put your class and your year and then your name here. Ta-da! Today we'll be swatching Viridian. What I like to do when swatching watercolor, a very thick layer swatch and then a very sheer swatch, and then a gradient, which is from thick to almost nothing. Let's do the watery one. Make sure you have a lot of water on your brush, and then you're basically shaping the water as you go. And then you can add more water along the way. If you're doing for fun, you don't have to get those fancy paper, because I think there's no bad paper, there's just no fitting to your use. And this is the first one. It might look a certain way, but that might not stay depending on the type of paint. And next one, I'll use more paint. And you just very different colors. There was one time I accidentally drank pink water because my cup was next to the color. And it was like orangey, so like I was like, hey, pink, my favorite drink. Wouldn't recommend it. So now, the fun part, the gradient part. You take a bit of pink, and then you put it at the corner of where the darkest color is gonna be. And then you take a bit of water, you slowly, right when it meets, overlap it a bit, so they kind of like melt into each other. If your paper is thick, it can hold water, the gradient will be quite smooth. If not, it might be a little streaky. Ta-da! So you can do other things. Some people put like salt, but for basic swatches, this will be how I do it. Another thing I like to do with watercolor is putting it on anything but watercolor paper. When we just went to lockdown last year, I had a bunch of construction paper and like watercolor pens. I'm using this kind of watercolor that kind of dries powdery. So when I use construction paper on them, they kind of get lighter than they would usually dry. I did zines with it. I cut out little pieces of paper from brochures and stuff, and then I painted little pictures on it. And then I just kind of like hot glue the back of it together, and then there you go, you made a book. You can do this with construction paper, which is one kind of swatch also. I chose pink because green and pink, they are on the opposite sides of the color wheel. So when you want something to stand out, you can bring them a contrasting friend. Already you can see the most diluted part of the swatch is like completely different colors. Somehow the more solid one feels a bit lighter here, brighter. Because when colors mix with their complementary, they darken themselves. So this is the more solid one. It's like I'm using this as if it's like pastel color, you know. Okay, gradient. First of all, the paper doesn't really hold heavy duty water like this. And secondly, the lighter color already looks like the darker color here. The green has a bit of blue hue in it, and it kind of makes the paper when it's wet a bit bluish, so it becomes like a bit purple. But I don't know what happens when it dries. We'll have to see. Watercolor cannot be impatient, man. Next, Taylor Rowney watercolor pen thingy. First of all, futuristic design, sleek, quite portable, it's really light. It has a little brush in it, so you don't have to squish this somewhere else. One thing that I would be concerned with is that one, you have to get your external water container. Secondly, one time after I finished painting with something like this, nice and compact and like secure, but it was too secure for the moisture. It got a bit moldy because I didn't dry it before I closed it. When I opened it up, the colors are kind of like gray. I remember to dry them out a bit. So we'll be using this darkish green. Same thing, more water for the sheerer one. Okay, this one's very bright. But then again, that one just dries, so I can't tell if when wet it's the same brightness. It's like when it rains outside, things get kind of more vibrant when it's raining, and then everything is slightly wet, like terracotta tiles.
This
one seems to hold quite well. Even when it's dry, it's kind of like caramel candy, you know, those like block kind, very chewy one. If this was like apple juice, this would be a bit like honey, a bit more viscous, a bit only. Based on these two, the first one is a bit streakier. Your watercolor is also applied with a brush. So the brush and its fur and like the shape of it will determine the shape of your color. Okay, gradient time. The gradient flows quite well. Because it's viscous, it kind of also pulls nicely, but then they are cliquish. So you might want to guide them with your brush. Okay, let's wait for it to dry while we do this one. So the first one is kind of half dry from the first swatch. It looks a bit bluish because of the paper, and the pigment itself has a bit of blue. For this one, it feels more like, it's not like pure green, because what is pure green then? Green is already a composite, but it looks like it has a bit more blue in the powdery formula kind of feeling. I'll just be talking on my butt. My impression is no brain cell, but still honest. Then gradient time. Now I learned from just now. They don't like to mingle with other strokes, so I have to help them. Okay, it's very hard to see the gradient when it's wet, but put it in the natural evaporation oven. Okay, the third one is Hobie In. Artist watercolor in permanent green number 2. I've never seen it before. Looks very atas, has like weight in it, quite substantial for like this thing. How much was it? $5.90 per thing. The Sakura one is like $12.60, so like maybe like 2.5 of these is like the whole Sakura thing. Atas. Let's try it. Satisfying first look. A bit gao. I just like moisturizer for tropical places like Singapore kind. Also because it's like, sometimes you squeeze a pin and got a of the watery and then the pigment come out. But this one doesn't, so makes me think that the fidelity to how it looks like will be quite high. High fidelity. It's a real Speedwagon song, I think. Quite saturated, which means a little bit of this paint goes a really long way. Quite even. I don't have to do too much of the spread. It's easy to use if you are into this type of paper, kind of like watercolor you want to paint like legitly in a way. So easy! So like this one was a bit like gao in terms of a pen type. This one is like that but easier to push around. Okay, gradient test. What you might want is to make sure that it doesn't give you funny like variations when you do this, because if you want to mix with something else, the middle color might clash. So this is what it looks like. I think I like it already even though it hasn't dried yet. How does it look like on construction paper? Somehow very smooth. Like because the construction paper heat the water and then become very dark. Then you kind of sometimes see the pigments floating around, especially for the slightly more affordable versions. This one just very even. Okay, very dark, cannot see. Moving on. Based on this, I feel like this will be too smooth out for the solider swatch. Yeah, it really reminds me of gouache. Like, it's a bit bouncy. It's so bright, it sits on the paper so brightly. I think the paper's never seen someone as bright as it before. And now it has. Okay, gradient time. It's like a very eager group of pigments. I feel like those kittens, you know, you find on the streets, but then they're socialized very well. Okay, let's see how what happens when this one dries. This one. Now it's dry halfway. When it gets a bit darker, it's not as vibrant. I mean, when it gets a bit dry, not like it's vibrant, but when it's still darker, it's not like a different tone, you know, like it's still the same tone, just a bit darker. Fourth one, Horadam Aquarelle Helio Green, which our friend has kindly told us Helios is the stencil sun green. Way smaller than just now. More expensive than just now. This is now $8.90 for this tube. This is like 2/3 of the Sakura. If you're just trying for fun and you buy this, right? Have fun with it. It is very dark, but the corners of it, where the paint is slightly smudged at the mouth, is already glowing this kind of color. I've never really used this kind of like expensive type. This one is like, it's trained, like it knows what it's doing. The color shade wise, just like in between the warm and the cool ones. And this one, I feel like it's very easy going. The shade also looks quite versatile. Let's do the thick version. Okay, when it wants to get darker, it's really easy to get darker. When I put down this amount of water, like it stays quite consistent. So you really get to choose like how saturated you want this little block to be. And this one will stay as you tell it to. But it's not dry yet, so we'll see later. Okay, gradient time. Okay, let me do this. It's quite evenly flowing. This is like the cousins, right? This one go to UK to study overseas, come back and all then like just like, Xiaoming ah, when are you gonna get a girlfriend ah? Hey, Ernest, when are you gonna get married? There's a different treatment, you know. What happens if the UK guy goes to the south to order fish? Can he stand the test or not? We'll see. This is the diluted version. It looks so far like how it behaved on here, except the construction paper struggling to remember like, huh, who are you, you know? Gradient time. The construction paper, I've never seen it interact with like smooth pigments like this before. When it dries, I think we'll be in for a surprise. Okay, we'll see how you do when it dries. This one is, ding ding, the ever popular. This one's 350 for this whole thing. So just now was 890, right? You buy this twice, you can't even afford that 1.25 ml. There's like a little brush also. If you use it, you might want to prepare yourself for the brush also being more than what you anticipate to be a part of the painting because the hair will fall. If it's for children to play with and they're kind of rough with their brushes, it's fine. But for you, you might find it hard to control. Okay, for this one, right, I like it for children as well because there's like palette side. They like to customize things as children. They can mix it here. You can also teach them about, like, you know, boundaries. Next time when they use yellow and orange, they will learn the lesson. When you take out the brush, next time you put it back, you bring it around your hair. Then you know you brought your brush. Then you know you didn't forget it. Today, I think we'll use this green. This is probably how they're gonna dry, but this is the best you get. But this will probably be my preferred way to use watercolors because affordable, portable, and just familiar with. And basically what you see is what you get. For example, just now the helio green didn't look like this straight from the tube, but this one is literally what you get. When you wet them, it gets a bit darker, right? Just remember when it dries more dull than you think because the texture of it gets powdery since it's like powdery cake. You can't really darken this. And sakura kind is a tube kind also. It kind of gets a bit darker. For the running one, it was like a different consistency. It's a bit goopier. They just don't dry completely. Gradient wise, the powder comes generously, but then again, it's like puppies that haven't been through like little training, you know, like they just go everywhere. So I'm lifting the color now to get the gradient back. It's eager in another way, lah. It's not the eager. I'm eager to perform, but this one is just like new place. Here I am. I think they are pretty basic. It's like people ask you if you know how to use Excel sheet, and it's like yeah, I do. And then you just know a bit of me. So this is the bit of me. And then if you actually did it like on your resume, right? You're like this. My zines. Usually I make them with the watercolor cake pen. Ones also. Mostly because for zines, the whole idea is that anyone can do it. You don't have to go through like a design school to make a book. You don't have to go through a publisher who likes your work to like make it into existence. I also like how it stays true to the spirit of zine. Honestly, although I paint a lot, the soft spot in my heart is the hard watercolor cake. Although they're really very hard to blend out. Excuse me. Okay, I don't think this will look like a gradient, but I'll try. Okay, you can dry now. For you, yeah, it looks like the same thing, but like the gradient happens when it's like, okay, like try lying. You know? Maybe not for the people who use gradients heavily, maybe for people who like what they see. I'm very excited about this one. Ta-da! It's a Pokeball. This is by a painter, paintmaker, artist, friend called Fatima Banu, and she runs the Inner Cosmology. where she hand makes a paint, so she gets pigment, she molds them herself. I think this one was $7 for this half pen thing. So sometimes people have these handmade pigments and then they might stick it onto like a tin so you can bring it around. And sometimes people have magnets behind so you can like kind of shuffle which colors you want. Now it's the sheer swatch. Texturally interesting. Reminds me of one of these just now where the pigments knew what they're doing. This one is a bit like the Taylor Rowney, but the goopiness that contributes the tricky part is not there. It's like this Taylor Rowney one, but a bit upgraded in terms of user experience. Yeah, I think the color, the pigments already are flowing very nicely, like here. You don't just use watercolor because of the affordability and the portability, but also for what it is, you know, I want to like work with water sometimes. That's also a part of the draw. You want to work with how the time element of it. Before it slightly dries, you get to like move it around. You get to introduce some blooms of color in. I think this is what I will use watercolor for. The interaction with the pigments, interaction with the medium. And the person who made it, I would like to support as many artists making their own piece as possible. It's a happy green. Feels very friendly, you know, the color. Not just a shade, but like in itself. Let's see how it holds on construction paper. I'm not sure how it will look like because I've only seen her work with her own pigments on watercolor paper. One thing that I really like about her pigment is that sometimes she makes duochrome colors, which I think is her specialty. Okay, gradient time. It seems pretty easy going with the construction paper even, despite the fact it's construction paper who has no idea what the color works on them. Kind of glowy, which means the pigments will stay this intensity or somewhere near it because it's kind of not really succumbing to wetness or like the paperness. Okay, now all our friends are gathered here. This is the watercolor paper and this is the construction paper. Now that it's kind of all dry, you can see that they're a bit more fluorescent when it's dry. Especially for like the cake, it's a bit lighter. The sakura one is also a bit brighter. Taylor Rowney, the tube ones, they all kind of work with the paper's tone and kind of gets a bit darker. The pigments really hold their own for the inner cosmology one. So these are bright. For me, I would prefer when they are more opaque, when they are a bit more vibrant in a sense, because I think it really adds a lot of visual impact when you're doing something more fun like arts and craft. Whereas on like the watercolor paper, I don't think there's like a better or worse, because it's really like the effect you want and also how well you are at like navigating the water for the pigment's sake. But I want like viscous, streaky kind of effects, like for example kefir. Maybe I can go for these, like the sakura one, where it's kind of like easy to control with the already being liquid part of it. And also the colors are pretty much what you see is what you get. In terms of vibrancy, you can't beat the artist's made one. It's not just the shade, but like the way it kind of comes alive on paper. I think this one is like, if you want to make a happy thing, you must use happy things. Like for someone, you are happy, the brush is happy, and then like, her paint is happy. But really you see how when the pigments roll around on the paper, it does look a bit more serious. Like, watercolor, you grow two moustache and when you paint, that kind of thing. If you want that kind of effort and effect and like quality, I think it's worth it. But I would say practice with those sakura kind for the tube or like the Taylor Rowney or the water cake. I think some water cake for the solid kind. Then you kind of get used to how the water and the pigments will behave before you move on to the ones that you really, really want to get the effect of. So I think there's no good or bad, it's just what occasion you're using it for. This is good for trying out at home for if you want to start with tube colors. For this, if you're kind of used to watercolors and you want to go out to try urban sketching, Taylor Rowney and this type of like small, cakey type of paints will be good. For Hobane and Horadam. Horadam colors, they are better in a sense if you're really comparing tube quality. But I guess Hobane, I like the flowery blooms it gets. For Horadam, they are a bit smoother. So depending on how expressive you want your tube watercolor artworks to look like. This one is perennial favorite, easy to experiment with, and also the gateway to this. which I think if you're confident enough to like really invest in colors, really get to choose a lot of shades. Sometimes these artists will also like customize their own shades or like shade that you want, and this one really brings you a lot of joy when you're painting. Bing.